Well, dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace. Amen. I want to begin this morning with just a brief informal survey. How many of you got up this morning and looked in the mirror? Anybody get up, look in the mirror? Okay. How many of you, after brushing your teeth and shaving or putting on your makeup and everything, looked in the mirror a second time? Anybody? That? Okay. And how many of you look better the second time than the first time? Okay, good. You know, facing the mirror in the morning for me is just not always a pleasant experience. I mean, I sometimes shouldn't tell you this, but I wake up with pillow creases in the side of my face or sleepers in my eyes, always some stubble on my chin. And when I wake up and look in the mirror in the morning, I realize, man, I got to get myself cleaned up because my morning mirror is pretty honest with me. You know, it kind of shows me right back the way I look. It doesn't compromise. My morning mirror doesn't gloss over my morning defects and tell me I'm better looking than I really am. In fact, my morning mirror shows me every wrinkle, every gray hair, less and less of that, but every blackhead on my nose and my bleary blue baby blue eyes. But you know, it's important to get up and look at the mirror in the morning because no matter how unpleasant it is to see our morning faces, it's best, at least for me, to remind myself that unless I make some adjustments, the world out there, I'm going to come in and Doris is going to say, what happened to you? You know, the morning is going to see my morning face, and that's not always a pretty sight. Most mornings, before we leave the house, we need to get a little cleaned up, or at least need to try. Now, the reason I mention that is because the Ten Commandments that we have before us today is kind of looking at a morning bathroom mirror. Because as we look at ourselves in the mirror of the Ten Commandments, most likely we see things that need to be cleaned up or adjusted a little bit or redirected before we face the rest of the day, the rest of the week, or the rest of our lives. In fact, when we look at ourselves in the mirror of the Ten Commandments, we can see creases in our lives, stubble on our chin, makeup that we need to have on, or makeover that we need to give ourselves to face the rest of the day, or, again, more importantly, the rest of our lives. Now, we're 4 weeks into the sermon series on the secrets of a meaningful life. Today, we're looking at the secret of spontaneity. And it may seem strange to look at the Ten Commandments as a basis for some spontaneity, but or even in the same sermon to talk about spontaneousness or freedom, and also about the Ten Commandments. But stick with me, and I think you'll see how I think they're connected. Now, you likely remember or have heard sermons or stories on Moses, how Moses received his call from God in Exodus chapter 3 out of the burning bush. God said, Moses, I want you to lead my people out of captivity in Egypt. You remember the plagues that were sent on the people in captivity and the pattern of Moses and Aaron going to the Pharaoh saying, let my people go. Pharaoh said, okay. And then the plagues, all of the 10 plagues, resulting in the final one of the firstborn son being killed. Pharaoh finally let the people go. The people of Israel, if you remember, were spared because the blood of the Lamb was put on their doorposts, much as we see how the blood of the Lamb Jesus forgives our sins when the angel of death passes over us. Remember how Moses and the people of Israel were running from the Pharaoh. They finally came to the Red Sea with the mountains beside them, Pharaoh and his armies behind them. And Moses put his staff in the water, and it miraculously parted. That is, the Exodus is a master story of the Bible, that deliverance for both the Jewish people and for Christians. The Exodus, having God deliver them from bondage, is a key primary deliverance story in the Bible. It's the first one, and it's a primary one. And it's foundational to understanding who God is. Now, with that, remember that the people then began their long journey, 40 years in the wilderness, starting in Exodus 16, I mention that because our first lesson that Pastor Chuck read is Exodus chapter 20. They began their wilderness wanderings in Exodus chapter 16. They found themselves with nothing to eat, and they complained about that to Moses and to God. So God says, okay, I'll give you quail. So I had manna. They then got thirsty. They said, we have no water. They complained to Moses and complained to God. So in chapter 17, Moses took that same staff, struck a rock, and they had water. In chapter 18, they were complaining to Moses so much about one another. He took my, you know, toasted oats while she did this. They were complaining so much that Moses couldn't handle their whining anymore and set up a series of judges to judge between them. In chapter 19, they finally reach Mount Sinai, and that's where it gets interesting and important, because Exodus chapter 20 is where we receive the Ten Commandments. And remember, Exodus is the second book of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth. And it is in Exodus 20 that we first come across the Ten Commandments that are given by God as a way in which God wanted them to lead their lives. What's interesting is that from the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis 2, Exodus chapter 20, God had not given them a lot of instructions or directions on how to live their lives. Remember Genesis chapter 3, and God says, you know, there's this tree in the middle of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Don't eat from that one. But then until Exodus 20, God made a covenant with Noah in Genesis 6 through 9. God made a covenant with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. But all the way to, through the deliverance through the Red Sea, to Exodus 20, God had not given them a lot of direction on how to live. Some key people in those chapters between Genesis 3 and Exodus 20, had an important relationship with God, Noah, Abraham, Moses, but God had not given them very much specific clue as to how to live. And so people were getting into squabbles. They were, some of them at that time had multiple wives. Apart from knowing that there were some people who knew God, there wasn't much for them to go on in terms of a living a life that was true to God. And so God took Moses up Mount Sinai and gave him the Ten Commandments. Moses goes up the mountain in thunder and lightning with a blast of the trumpet, and all of the camp trembled. Now, if you would take your bulletin and just look at Exodus 20 for a moment. It's the first time the Ten Commandments are mentioned. They're also mentioned in Deuteronomy chapter 20, but it kind of tells the same story. If you look at the first lesson, you'll see that God says on a mountain, remember, actually the words are not in this version, but there is the Hebrew word remember, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make of yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above or on earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third or fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make a wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. I'll quit there. But notice that the first word that God speaks as he begins the commandments, even though it's not in our text, it's in the Hebrew, God says, remember. Remember. I'm the Lord your God. I brought you out of the house of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. I brought you through. I delivered you through the Red Sea. I brought you to this place. Remember what I have done for you. Remember, God says, first of all. I lovingly delivered you from bondage and gave you freedom from captivity. Remember the freedom and liberation that I gave you. Remember the bondage that I delivered you from and brought you all the way here. Remembering is a key principle that begins the commandments. Remember how God loves you and God's delivered you. Because God says, if I've done all these things for you, remember that I am your God and I want priority in your lives. And if that's the case, don't talk bad about me. Don't take my name in vain. If I'm your God, respect my name. Watch what you say. Give honor to God. Spend a day of week in worship. Everything is based and predicated on remembering the deliverance that God gave to them. So remember that. And so, I think what that means is that the Ten Commandments are deeply relational, showing us how to have a relationship with God that's real and personal, how to have a right relationship with other people. The first three commandments deal with our relationship with God, kind of what we call the first tablet of the law. The second seven commandments, the second tablet of the law, concerns our relationship with one another. Remember, since God has done all of these things for you, don't have other gods, don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The next seven have to do with our relationship with others. Be good to your parents. Don't kill one another. Be faithful to your wife. Don't lie, steal, or cheat of anything that is your neighbor's. Within those parameters, God wants to say, if you remember that I'm your God and you're my people, there's a whole lot of freedom within those parameters. Don't kill one another, but you can have a lot of freedom within those parameters because they define what's acceptable and what's not. I mean, think of how important that is when you leave and drive home here. Think of stop signs not as a limit to your freedom, but as a way of creating order instead of chaos. Think if we had no speed limits or no stop signs, you'd leave here and it would just be chaos going home. Stop signs in the streets give order in the midst of chaos. Or think of train tracks that guide a train to a safe destination, or paved highways that allow you to get from one place to the other. Parameters create freedom to get from one place to another. Without train tracks, a train sitting in the middle of the field would never get anywhere, but with train tracks, you can get from one place to another. All of it is in a way in which to provide true peace and freedom and spontaneity within some kind of structure. Now, let's talk for a moment about the numbering of the commandments. If you look at our first lesson for today, you'll notice there's no numbering of the commandments. There's no numbering in the Bible of the commandments. It's referred to as the Decalogue, meaning that there's 10 of them, but there's nothing in our text that says, well, here's number 3, here's number 8. 10 commandments are not even referred to by number by Jesus. In fact, when Jesus mentions the commandments, he only mentions 7 out of 10 of them. So from the Bible, we don't get any guidance on how to number the commandments. What I find fascinating, Julie, can you click on that next slide? That there's 3 different ways in which the numbering of the commandments have developed over the years. On the right side, you'll see the Roman Catholic and Lutherans numbered them with the first commandment being, you shall have no other gods before me, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. And when you number them that way on the right-hand side with Roman Catholics and Lutherans, you come to the classic Lutheran problem that really there's 9 commandments. But since we have to have 10, we split the commandment about coveting into 2 commandments, right? When really, if you look at the text, there's 1 commandment on coveting, but the way that we know That's a classic Lutheran Catholic problem in numbering the commandments the way that we do. You'll notice from the middle two columns that other Christian denominations number the commandments in a little different way. The first commandment is like ours, you shall have no other gods, but then their second commandment has to do with you shall not make yourself an idol or graven images. Of course, Catholics don't have that as a commandment because of the icons that Catholics use, and so, you know, you have to kind of work with it. So, Catholics and Lutherans, I mean, that's just an interesting way in which to number the commandments. But if you look on the left side, we're right in the middle of the Jewish way of numbering them. The first commandment is remember. Remember. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. And then all of the other commandments flow from that. Because in the Jewish faith, all the commandments flow from that word of deliverance and remembrance. The first commandment for them is to be a remembering community of the gracious acts of God. And being reminded of the mighty deeds of God reminds you who you are and whose you are. Remembering that God is a God of deliverance who wants freedom and spontaneity for you. I'm reminded of a story of a little boy who built a toy sailboat. It was his pride and joy. He would take it to the park every day and sail his little boat in the pond. He loved watching it blow about in the breeze. He loved his boat. He was always careful in the pond to kind of keep it in a shallow end, not where it was too deep, where if the wind took it, he couldn't retrieve it. One day when the winds were strong, the boat sailed out into the deep far beyond where he could retrieve it, and he found himself kind of getting wax a little almost over his head to try to get it back, but it had gone too far for the boat to have him rescue it. And so he went home heartsick, expecting he'd never see his little boat again. But a few weeks later, he was walking through town when he saw his little boat that he had made in the window of a pawn shop. He was elated, and he went in and he said, "Hey, you found my boat. I made that boat. I want it back." And the man behind the counter said, "Well, maybe it was your boat once, but it's mine now, and if you want it back, you're going to have to pay $20 for it." Well, the little boy had no idea how he was going to come up with that kind of money, so he hung his head and started to walk out of the store. The man behind the counter said, "Well, if you want to earn a little money, I suppose I could use some help around here." And so the little boy started working for the store owner and sweep the floor and tidy the shelves. The man would give him a couple of dollars. Finally, the day came when he had enough money in his pocket of crumpled bills. He went back to the store and bought his boat back. He was thrilled, and as he walked out of the store, he held that little boat that he had made like a prized treasure, and he said to the boat, "Now you're mine twice. You were mine in the first place when I made you. You're mine now because I bought you back." There was no doubt that boat now really belonged to him. In the same way God made you, God created the world and all that exists, and we've wandered out into the deep waters where the Bible says we've gone our own way, where we like sheep have gone astray, away from the shepherd, beyond our capacity to get back to the fold or to the family, where we sit in the pig pen messes that we've made of ourselves, being prodigals from God. But God loved the world so much that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. God loved us so much that not only did he make us, but he sent us Jesus, his only son, to buy us back from sin, death, and the power of the devil. And so we're God's twice, because he made us in the first place and he bought us back with the blood of Jesus. So there's no doubt about who we are and whose we are. All that God asks is that we remember. Is that we remember. Remember that God brought us out of slavery and bondage to sin. God bought us and brought us back by the blood and sacrifice of Jesus. All he asks is that we love him above all. all else and love our neighbors as ourselves. Those are the parameters of a God-centered life that begins with remembering. Remembering God is our God. And so we look at the Ten Commandments as a mirror which reflects our lives back to us. Those are the images, those are the actions, those are the heart of what God wants for us. To love God above all else and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Remember, God says, remember, I am your God. Love me and serve one another. That's the joy and freedom and spontaneity of the Christian life. Let's close in prayer. Gracious.